Good evening and welcome to the LSE on this special occasion. As you know, we're having tonight the debate, which is our inaugural debate organized by the LCIA, the London Court of International Arbitration, and the LSE, the London School of Economics, under the title of Quo Vadis London, International Arbitration and Commercial Law in More and Less Cosmopolitan Times. We are delighted to have all of you here. We are slightly surprised because about 450 people signed up, so we even have another room to spill over if the masses still arrive, but a Friday evening, I guess, is difficult for some people. But we are very happy to see you so numerous here, and I pass to Jackie.
It is indeed a great pleasure to be here, and I would first like to thank Jan, our host, for the hospitality here. It is indeed a great pleasure for the LCA to be able to team up with the LSE. And as I walked over here, I thought, actually, Jan and I are the perfect illustration of what makes London so special. You have a German and a Dutch, and we live and work here and thrive in this environment, this truly international environment where people from all over the world, including a few Brits, come to work and do arbitration. And we see fantastic universities, great law firms, barristers' chambers, but also the other providers to the, let's say, arbitration industry come together in this unique place. The occasion for this event is also a unique one. We started discussing this, well, I guess almost two years ago, because we were both, of course, familiar with the Vienna moot, and the LSE had already, for quite a while, done a very successful pre-moot. And I also realized that for the LCIA, to get involved in a pre-moot was a very valuable opportunity. Pre-moots, moots offer training, recruitment, networking services, if you will. They are unique tools for all of us in this industry to get together and to enjoy being together. So I very much welcome the opportunity to start working together and make the successful LSE events even more successful by co-running it and combining, contributing the pool of arbitrators that we as LCIA have access to. We then started thinking, well, it would be such a shame if we only did the pre-moot because we will bring together so many unique people. Let's do something to commemorate these special sessions. And that's when we started thinking about doing a lecture or a debate for the coaches, the students, the practitioners, the academics, and make it even more interesting to spend a weekend here in London. The format of a debate, I think, is absolutely appropriate for something like a moot or a pre-moot. It's not just about a static lecture. It is about seeing people, well, potentially even, I think, hit each other to make their point, and then ultimately, undoubtedly, for both of them to be successful. And today is special because we're going to be hearing a lot of discussion about the CISG, which is essential to the whole system of the Vienna moots. That's what I mean. That was their cue. I do not want to prejudge the outcome of tonight, but I am confident that in whichever way, London is going to come out even stronger also after tonight as a place for arbitration. And I very much look forward to hosting many more LSE-LCA pre-moots and debates. And I hope tonight is going to be informative and not too bloody. And finally, I leave it to you for a few more words.
Yes, thank you, Jackie. We indeed are very much indebted at LSE for the cooperation with LCIA, let alone because I think the London pre-moot now is certainly the pre-moot where you have the very best arbitrators of all pre-moots. One of the big challenges in Vienna is, of course, of finding enough arbitrators for this huge competition. Here in London, for a rather small pre-moot with 12 teams, finding arbitrators was not a problem at all, thanks to the LCIA's amazing network. So the mooters can look forward to having probably much better arbitrators in London than in Vienna. I will just briefly introduce the speakers to you. Many of you will know them. I will start with Professor Ingeborg Schwenzer, who is the Dean of the Swiss International Law School and Professor Emerita of Private Law at the University of Basel in Switzerland. And she has been visiting and held adjunct positions in numerous universities across the world. She is most famous for being the main editor and the editor of Schwenzer, the commentary on the Convention on the International Sales of Goods, which basically every mutter considers to be a Bible, and which has appeared in the fourth edition last year with Oxford University Press and has been published as well in German, Spanish, Portuguese, and Turkish. Ingeborg is also the chair of the CISG Advisory Council, and she regularly acts as arbitrator, counsel, and legal expert in international disputes. The other contender is Sir Bernard Eder of Essex Court Chambers, who has practiced as a barrister for almost 35 years, specializing in commercial litigation and international arbitration, covering a wide range of disputes, including shipping law, international trade, banking, construction, commodities, and energy law. He took circa 1990 and sat as a judge at the High Court of Justice from 2011 to 2015, especially in the commercial court. And since 2015, Sir Bernard is also an international judge at the Singapore International Commercial Court. And he's the editor, the senior editor of Scruton on Charter Parties and Bills of Lading. And to be sure that at an arbitration event, impartiality reigns and justice as well, we have the great honor to have Paul Klaas here, who is both a barrister in England and Wales, as a member of Maitland Chambers, and is also a member of the Minnesota Bar in the United States, a truly cosmopolitan arbitrator. He's a seasoned litigator, arbitrator, and he teaches arbitration in Minnesota and at Harvard Law School. With that, we leave it to Paul to take over.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jan, and thank you, Jackie, for hosting this wonderful event, and good evening to all of you. There will be no physical violence. I have placed myself between Ingeborg and Bernard. So I'm sorry if you'd like to leave now. Please be quiet on your way out. We're going to cover four general topics tonight. First is the discussion as to whether Brexit itself is going to affect London as an international dispute resolution center. Secondly, is the preeminence of English law waning for international commercial disputes. Thirdly, should international commercial transactions start avoiding national law, including English law, and embrace more cosmopolitan bodies of law, for example, the Convention for the International Sale of Goods, or the CISG. And finally, and I hope you all have a little index card-sized piece of paper with Article 8 of the CISG on it, that'll be our final focus. We focus on it for two reasons. First, it is quite different from the English law that most of us are familiar with. And secondly, it's as all of the advocates and coaches participating in this year's VIS International Commercial Arbitration moot know, there is a very important CISG Article 8 issue buried in that problem. So we thought it would be good to hear from our combatants about that. So a particular welcome to our advocates and our coaches for the VIS moot. We look forward to seeing you this weekend. The three of us have been sharpening our teeth and waiting for the rounds to begin. So we'll see you at the pre-moot and then see you in Vienna. First, Brexit and London. I wanted to start by showing you some fake news from the New Yorker magazine in the US. This is the headline of the story that ran the day after the Brexit vote. British lose right to claim that Americans are dumber. And the source is Alistair Dorenson, a pub owner in North London, who says that British voters have done irreparable damage to the most enjoyable sport this nation has ever known, namely treating Americans like idiots. Quote, "This is a dark day," he said, "but I hold out hope that come their November election, Americans could prove dumber than us once again." I'm sure at least Alistair Dorenson is a very happy fellow at the moment. But the debate is not about whose self-inflicted wound is most grievous. It's not even about whether Brexit is a good idea or a wise choice. We're assuming that the choice has been made, although hard and soft, and Scotland and all these things I understand are still burbling around. The choice has been made, and the question for our debaters is, will Brexit affect London as an international commercial dispute resolution center? Specifically, will Brexit make the UK more insular and cause London to degenerate to yet another offshore center for taking care of dirty laundry? Bernard.
Well, the short answer is no. It is not going to have that effect. There are a whole lot of other things that might affect London, and we can discuss this. But I think on this particular point, both Ingeborg and I can keep our boxing gloves behind us. In terms of arbitration, I think particularly there is no problem at all. Arbitration will continue in London and it will continue to grow. You have the New York Convention, you have the New Hague Convention. In terms of enforceability, which is the crucial question for most parties involved in arbitration, there is absolutely no problem at all. And as I say, although there might be other reasons that might affect London, I do not think that Brexit will have any effect whatsoever on London.
Ingeborg.
Well, Bernard, you know that I agree mostly. There might be some impacts, however. Some users may feel a certain uncertainty that it might not be as easily possible to bring in witnesses or arbitrators at short notice into England anymore. And there may be perceptions from outside London or England has a certain local flavor, and this might be supported even with Brexit, sometimes highlighted by certain wig and gown approach, and by from outside perceptions this might increase, and that in the end might influence London as an arbitration place.
Fog in channel, continent cut off. Ingeborg, if London is going to be okay generally, are there threats, though, other than Brexit, that you see to London as a future international commercial dispute resolution center?
Yes, I think it's not connected to Brexit and to Europe, but it's connected to global developments, and it's connected to economic developments. Economy is moving to Asia, and Europe is becoming less and less, Europe in itself is becoming less and less important. And this is clearly also shown by all the statistics we receive from Hong Kong or Singapore, or with new arbitration centers popping up even in Africa or in the Middle East. So as economy moves away from London, from Europe, this certainly influences arbitration.
Bernard, what do you think?
Well, I agree in part, but let me just go back, because Ingeborg is completely wrong on her early answer.
Good,
if I may
excellent.
Say so. I mean, she is right. There may be a perception out there that England has problems, but the perception is simply fake news, that's what I think. And the sooner people realise that that is so, the better. So, for example, I've travelled around the world quite a lot in the past year or two. Wherever I go, there is a myth that the English courts interfere too much in arbitration, and that there are three levels. There's the arbitration court, Court of Appeal, Supreme Court, and that this all delays things in arbitration. I've done a study on that. It is completely untrue. In England, probably there are about, no one really knows, 5,000, 6,000 arbitrations started every year. The English courts intervene in a minute number of those, and generally speaking, they do not interfere at all. There are applications, but they don't interfere at all. So in terms of fake news, she is right, but in terms of actual news, she is completely wrong. She is right as well that going as trade moves to the Far East, as China grows, as India grows, as Singapore grows, unsurprisingly, there will be other dispute resolution centers around the world, and that is unsurprising. And it will go with the trade. So traditionally, for example, if you had a shipbuilder in China and a buyer in Greece, that would historically generally come to London, either to the courts or to arbitration in London. Now, it is not surprising that those cases do not have to come to London and might go somewhere else. And we will see that growth in the next 10, 20 years. There's no doubt at all about that. But have no doubt that London will remain as the dominant place for arbitration, provided, and this is an important point, provided it is not complacent, both in terms of arbitration and in terms of the court. And I am the fiercest critic, in a way, of both the court and arbitration, in the sense that it has got to make sure that it continues to be an efficient place to resolve disputes. And complacency is the biggest threat to London arbitration.
Do you agree, Ingeborg?
Certainly I don't. I mean, if we
listen to my accent, I'm familiar with fake news. go ahead, Ingeborg.
I think if we take statistics, I don't have them at hand, but I looked them up before coming here. It's certainly not right that you can say that London, to the very day, is the dominant place of arbitration. So, and I think, you know, having a party from China or from Brazil or Turkey and Brazil, they certainly won't go to London. I have seen more and more cases in Switzerland, and they are choosing Swiss law and a seat of arbitration. They are choosing Zurich. So no way that Asian parties and South American parties will go to London. But
I actually assign my students a task of negotiating an arbitration agreement between a fantasy Turkish party and a fantasy Australian party. It has nothing to do with London, has nothing to do with England. And every year, a third of them come back. They've designated London as the seat and English law as the controlling law. It's an astounding, consistent pattern that, I don't know, Ingeborg. It's, at least it's still hanging on somewhat. And maybe if their students are doing it, it's a portent for another generation.
Among common law lawyers, among common law students. But as I will be come back, I mean, now we have among the 20 leading trade nations in the world, there are more than 70% civil law countries. It's no longer the common law countries that are leading, and we are moving away from the 19th century, actually. Yeah, I mean, no, actually, I was coming to this later, but I might already mention it now. If you go back 150 years, England and the British colonies made up for 31% of world trade. 31%, one third. And you know what it's gone back to? One tenth. 3% of world trade is now done by the UK.
I think along the way they lost some of those colonies, didn't they?
Yeah, that's a pity. You shouldn't have given them away.
No, this is all wrong. Let me get you. The important thing is everything has to be evidence-based. People can say this, but it's not based on evidence. And let me give you evidence. I did a case in the High Court in London about 5 years ago.
No, this is called an anecdote.
It's an anecdote. Yeah. No. Two, I hesitate to use the word crooks, but there are two people in Russia, man A and man B. Man A thinks that the KGB is going to come and get him. So they're in a flat in Moscow, and man A says to man B, I'm worried that the KGB are going to come and get me. I'm going to put all my shares, all my property, in your name, so that if they come and get me, and I'm sent to Siberia, then when I come out, you can give them all back to me, and the property will be secure. Good idea, he says. They sign this piece of paper. I exaggerate a little. 10 minutes later, the KGB knock on the door. They take Mann A away, and he goes to Siberia for 7 years. Comes out of Siberia, comes back to Moscow, goes to his friend and says, here's the agreement that you signed. Give me my shares back. And he says, I never signed that. You never gave me anything at all, he says. A dispute arises. But the interesting thing is this, that when the KGB are knocking on the door in Moscow, the parties agree in this agreement to resolve their disputes in London under English law. Not in Switzerland.
No,
okay,
because
not in
troops,
Paris,
troops
not in New York.
Go to England, not to Switzerland.
Now, there is a view that we don't want that kind of work here in London, which is a different point.
Ingeborg, let me ask you, you accused me of having only common law students. That, too, was fake news. But the let me ask you why you draw out the distinction between the common law and the civil law. As we know, English law is a very, very popular choice for international transactions. A lot of people are still designating English law. I think probably if we're to look at the preeminence of English law in the future, we've got to know, do the civil lawyers think it's attractive still?
I think we have to go back and ask ourselves, why has it been attractive, and has it lost this attraction? As I said, 150 years ago, English law was very attractive because England amounted to one-third of world trade, and English law was developed. Whereas civil law legal systems were not developed at the time. It was a chaos. And you had, for example, in Germany, you didn't have a civil code yet at that time. It was the Bavarian, the Prussian, but no single civil code. Likewise in other legal systems. But that has changed during the last 150 years, yeah? And now what we do have, actually, is a convergence of the civil law legal systems based on the CISG. We will come back to that. I mean, we also have a convergence, actually, between civil law and common law. We do have it in arbitration. When we are sitting on panels of arbitration and it's not a pure common law panel, then we are living comparative law, and there is a convergence, especially also in the procedure of arbitration, that is no longer pure common law or pure civil law. We are living comparative law. So the world has changed, and just the pure common law is no longer apt to solve the disputes of the 21st century.
So English law, just a minor part of the convergence under the supervision of the CISG?
I cannot believe that Ingeborg can make so many mistakes in the course of such a short period of time. English law has been great. Why has it been great? It has been great because it focuses on two things. One is certainty, and in relation to that, the other is principle. English law proceeds on principle, whereas civil law proceeds on rather wide concepts which do not encourage certainty. Now, I agree with Ingeborg to this extent, that over the past 20 years, English law has deteriorated. It has deteriorated because of a number of cases in the English courts which encourage uncertainty. So the English law has developed in relation to factual matrix, in relation to implied terms, in relation to the reasonable expectations of an honest man. What have the reasonable expectations of an honest man got to do with English law and certainty? And my own view is English law has gone wrong over the past 20 years. But why? Because of the influence of civil law in England. And I know this because I'm sitting as a judge in Singapore as well. And Singapore, on the points that I've just mentioned, differ from English law. Singapore law, although it was equivalent to English law in 1987, over the past 30 years, has focused on the principle and certainty aspects that had underlined English law for 100, 200 years. And so when I sit in Singapore, I have to wear a different hat so far as ordinary contract principles are concerned to English law. I mean, take, for example, if I may, an anecdote. I'm particularly upset about this, about a recent case where I was overturned in the Court of Appeal recently.
And he doesn't worry about that. He's just fine with that.
No, I'm waiting for the Supreme
Court. Supreme Court, yeah, sure.
Supreme Court, sir. Is,
not often
how
isn't
do you
there
approach,
anymore.
How do you approach an exclusion clause? How do you approach the proper construction of an exclusion clause? In my view, maybe I'm an old Spanish purist, you adopt the view, I don't like to use Latin, you construe it strictly against the person who is seeking to rely on it. If it's ambiguous, you construe it strictly. Says the Court of Appeal, that is wrong. That is the wrong approach as a matter of law. The law in England now is fair reading, that exclusion clauses are no different from ordinary clauses. So English law has undergone a complete change. The members of the audience who are of my age will realize that this is complete heresy, and the sooner is it overturned, the better. So I agree with Ingeborg on this point, that English law has gone downhill, but it's the result of the influence from the continent.
Well, Bernard, first of all, what you say, strict construction...
How many mistakes did he just make?
Oh, quite a few.
More than you did. Okay, all right.
I'm sure. So, first of all, strict construction of exclusion clauses. You know which concept you just used? It's the concept of venire contra factum proprium. And this is coming from civil law, not the vague construction of exclusion clauses. So if there is a clause that is ambiguous, you interpret it against the person who brought it forward. So that's the first point. But my second point is, you're not really sure that English law is predictable? I mean, just take a concept like consideration. I mean, all people here who studied English law and who studied consideration for a couple of months, you do not want to tell me that this is a predictable law? I mean, why don't many civil law parties not like English law? It's because it's not predictable. I think actually...
In what regard specifically?
Well, for civil law parties, a law that is contract law in its core areas based on hundreds of years of legal precedents, for
see
them...
See, she started at 150... He went to 200. Now we're going hundreds of years. Okay.
I mean, consideration doctrine goes back really hundreds of years. So, and I think there are prejudices on each side. For civil law lawyers, core areas of contract law that are based on precedents is not predictable. Whereas there are prejudices on the common law side, thinking, oh, if there is a notion like good faith in a civil code, that is entirely unpredictable. But what do we have if we have good faith in a civil code? You have hundreds, you have thick, thick layers of precedents interpreting good faith in certain circumstances. So, in a way, good faith, the good faith principle is nothing else but the precedence under English law, under common law.
Now, even the Americans are prepared to imply good faith into contracts, Bernard. Why not the Brits?
Oh, because it's too gooey. That's what I think. It's just too gooey. English law, I agree, has developed principles which are, in particular respects, perhaps similar to good faith in terms of result. That is right. But, and this is important, principle tells you in particular areas how that aspect, that matter, works. So, for example, in relation to the sale of a car, the sale of an ordinary good in those circumstances. English law has developed particular principles. Now you find them in the Sale of Goods Act. For example, that the goods must be of merchantable quality, that they must be fit for purpose. So what English law does, it considers a particular problem and defines by principle what the particular standard is, for example. Take another example. You've got a contract. You want to withdraw from it in a certain situation, or a party in that situation, let us say, wants to claim a continuing debt. There's a recent case in the Court of Appeal about that in the shipping context. Can the claimant in that case continue to claim day by day money for a year, 2 years, 3 years? And it was suggested at first instance by a fantastic judge that that issue was to be resolved by good faith, in the sense that it would be bad faith to continue to claim the amount month after month after month. And the Court of Appeal rightly in that case says, good faith has got nothing to do with that. English law develops it by principle. The question is, does the claimant have a legitimate interest in continuing to claim that? Now, it may be that the result may be the same, but English law works on the basis of identifying what the relevant legal principle is, whereas in my view, good faith is just too gooey. I can't do better than that.
Gooey?
Well, I don't think so. As I try to explain, I think civil law countries have developed a lot of case law for good faith. So you can really tell whether, for example, breaking off negotiations, under what circumstances breaking off negotiations would lead to a damages claim. And they are akin to what you would say is covered by a fraudulent conduct. So I think what we should do, and that is my main concern, is we should no longer be concerned with the phrases like, my law is better than yours. What we should do is sit down and discuss the issues that we are concerned with. For example, let's sit down and say, under which circumstances breaking off of negotiation should lead to damages. And if we call that good faith, or if we call it a fraudulent conduct, I don't care, actually. And I think we should discuss the issues and not some vague concepts.
Well, I think that leads us to the third general topic I wanted to touch on tonight, which is, gooey or otherwise, and rather than have debates as to whose law is better, should the international commercial transaction world start just abandoning national law along with English law and adopt the more widely accepted Convention for the International Sale of Goods? I mean, it has been ratified by, at this point, I think 85 countries. Ingeborg, what do you think? Just forget about national law. Let's go with a treaty.
Yeah, my answer is a clear yes. I mean, we are living in a world of globalization. It's not only globalization of trade, but it's also the globalization of the legal profession. The big law firms, they have offices around the world. In arbitration, we are sitting together, arbitrators from civil law countries, from common law countries. Our students, they are moving around. I mean, our students are taking part in moot court competitions. They are studying abroad. Also, the young lawyers are going anywhere. You have common law lawyers practicing in civil law countries and vice versa. You have, as Jackie just mentioned, I mean, nowadays we have so many civil law lawyers teaching students here in England English law.
That's because it's preeminent, right?
That will have an incredible impact on the development of English law. I'm very sure about that. And I think the time has passed for legal colonialism. And as I just mentioned, I think it's much more important that we sit together and that we discuss the problems that we face in the 21st century, discuss very, very basic contract problems coming from England, for example, the Ruxley case. That's a very important question, or disgorgement of profits. And we should sit down and discuss these and not discuss questions of the 19th century consideration or good faith. And actually...
So, Bernard, are you prepared to abandon English law, or are you a colonialist?
I'm a colonialist, born and bred. I agree that there are many parts of the CISG that are excellent. They codify matters and they are excellent. But there are certain parts of it which I am fundamentally against. And we'll come to Article 8 in a minute. But one of them, it's, you don't have it, is Article 7. It says, in the interpretation of the convention and the other things, regard must be had to the observance of good faith in international trade. Good faith. Now, what on earth does that mean? Take an example, and again, I agree with Ingeborg, examples are what really test particular questions. Take a simple case, a shipbuilding contract. The contract provides that the ship shall be delivered by a latest date, 31st of December 2014. And the contract expressly provides that if the ship is not ready by that date, the buyer will be entitled to cancel. Very simple case, happens again and again, many times. The ship has a navigation system which operates on software. The software is not ready on the 31st of December. There's a glitch in it. And it's going to take 3 days to get it repaired. 3 days. But on that day, on midnight, on the 31st of December, there is no doubt that ship cannot sail. It is not ready. It's not de minimis. It's not ready. The market has fallen. The buyer doesn't want to take the ship, not because it's 3 days late, but because the market has fallen. Is it in breach of good faith to exercise a contractual right of termination? My view is that the contract gives an express contractual right to terminate. And bringing into that concept, that whole area, questions of good faith, introduce uncertainty in a way, in a contractual situation, which is, to an English lawyer, and in my view to any lawyer, is anathema.
Oh, I can tell you what good faith means. According to the American Uniform Commercial Code, it means honesty in fact and the observance of reasonable commercial standards of fair dealing in the trade. Surely that helps you resolve your problem, Bert. Ingeborg.
Everyone's put their hands in their hands.
Ingeborg.
Bernard, actually, you did not read Article 7, Para 1 properly, because Article 7, Para 1 of the CISG tells us that in interpreting the convention, regard is to be had to good faith in international trade, but not in interpreting the behavior of the parties. And actually, if the parties agreed upon a certain delivery date and made time of the essence, there is no question under the CISG that the buyer may avoid the contract in that case if the ship is not delivered by midnight on the 31st of December. So, 2 points. Read Article 7.1 carefully. Read
Thank
it
you,
carefully.
Professor. The, now, let me ask you, Bernard. The United Kingdom is the major trading country in the world that has not ratified the CISG. The Americans have. I think all of the top 10 or 15 countries other than the UK and India have ratified the CISG. Should the UK ratify the CISG?
Not in the form, not in this form. So the answer to your question is no.
All right, let me ask you, if the UK did ratify the CISG, do you think that English lawyers and their clients and sometimes their courts would avoid it and ignore it as enthusiastically as the American lawyers, clients, and courts have ignored the CISG? Notwithstanding the fact that it's part of American law. Do you think the English would do the same?
Yes. My view is no lawyer involved in major international trade, properly advised, could agree a contract on the terms of the CISG in this form.
Ingeborg.
Well, first of all, I'm convinced England, or it's still Great Britain, should indeed become a member of the CISG, and that is for very selfish reasons. I think the CISG world would embrace these brilliant English legal mind like yours.
Ooh, tactical, tactical, huh?
To interpret and to develop the CISG. I mean, and really to embrace the questions and the challenges we are facing in the 21st century.
That is definitely not what has happened in the United States, even though the United States has ratified the CISG. Why is that?
Well, actually, we do have around 200 published court decisions, American court decisions, dealing with the CISG. We do have many, many arbitral awards that we do not know how many.
Let me tell you why I say that, Ingeborg, and you may be familiar. You're familiar with Professor John Coyle's study from the University of North Carolina, published in the University of Pennsylvania Law Review just a few months ago. What John Coyle did was, in the United States, if you're a public company, you have to file your material contracts with the Securities and Exchange Commission. They become public record. What John Coyle did was search that public record looking for the words international sale of goods. He got 5,092 hits. 5,028 of those 5,092 hits was to exclude the application of the CISG to the contract. John Coyle concludes, quote, to the extent that the CISG has a constituency in the United States, that constituency appears to consist principally of law professors. Now, that's a reasonably skilled empirical study, isn't it?
No, it isn't, actually. We do have a specialist among the audience, actually, who carried out a global survey on the question of choice of law clauses. And he found out, maybe he will talk a bit about it during our discussion. What he found out is...
No, you're on your own, Ingeborg. You can't call up friends.
Well, parts of this survey have already been published in the Uniform Law Review and here with Oxford University Press, but the whole study will be published. But actually, the reason why do parties exclude the CISG? And the reason is mostly, in 95% of the cases, ignorance. For example, I'll give you an example. Let me bring an anecdote now, too. I had an arbitration about 1.5 years ago. The two parties, one, we had an American party and we had a German party. And the whole contract was based on the UCC. Why? The American party hoped to get a choice of law for New York law. But the German party didn't agree. So what did they do in the end? Okay, neither German nor American law. Okay, we choose Swiss law. And now they chose Swiss law. Both didn't know anything about the CISG. Actually, they didn't know anything about any international instruments, which is clearly proven by their choice of law clause. They said Swiss law to the exclusion of any ancitral and unidra laws. For those of you who know anything about unidra, unidra has never done a law, yeah? That is soft law principles. So they didn't even have a clue what these international institutions do. And actually, that was a very great case, because the American party would have won under the CISG. It lost under Swiss law. So, I think, and that is a point, what we are facing. First of all, I think common law parties will have will not be able to exclude the CISG. For example, when they contract with the Brazilian party now, or with the Chinese party, because Chinese law is the CISG, the Chinese contract law of 1999 is practically the CISG, so Chinese parties are not are not able or they do not want to exclude the CISG. And the next point is we do have cases where clients sued their lawyers for malpractice because they excluded the CISG without ever thinking what that might include for their clients. So we have the first malpractice cases in all over the world, and well, that might even lead an American lawyer to have a look at the CISG and to think beforehand whether the CISG might be better fit for their contract than any other law.
I can think of a defense in the United States of America since malpractice is departure from accepted standards of practice, where 5,028 out of 5,092 went the same direction as the exclusion. I think that might be helpful. Bernard, what do you think generally?
Oh, I haven't changed my mind.
I'm shocked.
And we'll come to other bits. Maybe we're coming in a
let's,
moment.
Well, you know, do you want to let us turn to eight, Article 8.
Article 8.
Can you get your cards? Your little index cards have the full text of Article 8 of the CISG. Right. Those of you who are participating in the Viz Moot can already recite it, very likely. The little addendum issue, as you'll recall, in the Viz Moot problem is an Article 8 problem. Now, before we, I want to hear principally, I think, from Ingeborg about Article 8, but I want to set the table really with the alternative, which is the really classical, formal, objective theory of the law of contract. And the Americans are behind on this. I accept the accusation. Many of the things in the United States did freeze in the 18th century. One of our still, I think, probably the most highly regarded American legal thinker of all times was Oliver Wendell Holmes. Here's what he wrote in the Harvard Law Review in 1897. In the law of contract, the use of moral phraseology leads to confusion. All contracts are formal. The making of a contract depends not on the agreement of two minds in one intention, but on the agreement of two sets of external signs. Not on the parties having meant the same thing, but on their having said the same thing. Now, the corollary of that classical, formal, objective theory of contract is two things, the plain meaning rule and the parallel evidence rule. The plain meaning rule, which is the dominant law still in the U.S., is if a contract is unambiguous, it's enforced as written. The parallel evidence rule is if the contract is unambiguous, extrinsic evidence offered to prove the intent of the parties that predates the contract, specifically including any negotiations that led to the contract, are inadmissible. The court will not hear them. Now, the plain meaning rule and the parallel evidence rule do not apply under the CISG. And the question is, Article 8 really is the core of the CISG's contract interpretation model. Ingeborg, can you describe for us how it's different or how it's the same?
Yeah, sure. We have to recollect the CISG in all of its parts is a compromise between common law and civil law. And there are many instances where the CISG rules start from the common law rule, like, for example, revocability of offers starts from the consideration rule and then goes to the civil law solution. And there are other instances where the CISG starts from the civil law principle and moves on to the common law principle. And Article 8 is an example of the latter. So it starts in paragraph 1 of Article 8 with a subjective interpretation. It asks what has been the intent, the subjective intent of the parties. And that is a tribute to civil law notions, which goes back even to Immanuel Kant, and then 19th century Savigny, that is the subjective intent is the core principle of being bound to something. But then, if we really have a look at reality, Article 8, Power 1 is never applied, actually. Because what happens? If we have a dispute between parties, Party A will say, oh, I intended A, and Party B will say, I intended B. So we can never find a subjective intent by the parties. So then we have to turn to Article 8, Para 2. And this is the common law approach, and that is the objective interpretation of the behavior of the parties. And there we ask ourselves, what would reasonable people in the shoes of the contracting parties have meant if they have used words like that? And I agree, there is a difference. There is a difference lying in Article 8, Para 3, and that is that under the CISG, indeed, neither the plain meaning rule nor the parallel evidence rule can be applied, because under the CISG, to find an objective interpretation of the behavior of the parties, we may rely on their previous or subsequent conduct. So indeed, this is a difference, but it's a difference. It doesn't say that the parole evidence rule is better than this solution. And I have to tell you, I love differences. They make life and they make the world much more interesting than if we just have one solution.
Article 8.3 of the CISG, among other things, says, in determining the intent of a party or the understanding of a reasonable person would have had, due consideration is to be given to all relevant circumstances of the case, including the negotiations. What do you think, Bernard?
Well, just step back, if I may, just a little. I'm an Oliver Wendell Holmes person, I should tell you. So just go back, if I may, so far as what Ingeborg says on 8.1. 8.1 is subjective intent. And I agree with her, that's what it's directed at, plainly so. But I disagree with her to this extent. She says, if A says this is my intent, and B says that is my intent, then you'll never be able to know what the intent is. That's wrong. What happens as a matter of practice in the roles building day by day, or would happen, or in arbitration, is that you'd spend a week trying to persuade the other party that he's wrong, that's not his intent. And Ingeborg's approach, if I may say so, is one at a theoretical level. It doesn't deal properly with the questions that judges have to deal with day in, day out. And that is why subjective intent is so pernicious. It should have no place whatsoever in the application of contract law. Coming then to three is another aspect of that, because it allows in negotiations. Now, I did a case in the High Court, a case called the Fulcanara, construction of a contract. Both parties adduced evidence of negotiations. Three old men in a bar in Singapore at midnight, a few weeks, 6 weeks before the contract was signed, with music blaring in the background. For 2 days, I had to sit in court listening to their evidence as to what they thought they heard the other person say with regard to negotiations. I held, and it cost £20,000 a day to do a court hearing in court. Spent probably £40,000-£50,000 listening to this evidence. I held that all three men were honest witnesses. They were all doing their best to recollect what they thought they heard in this bar on the 20th floor in Singapore. It's called the Fullerton Nightclub Bar. I did say, I told the parties I knew there and been there. They were very impressed by that. But I held that all of them were honest. All of them were giving the best recollection they could. But I said I couldn't find, on a balance of probability, that any of them was telling the truth. So it was in any event, I said that it was inadmissible anyway as a matter of English law. It's a complete waste of time.
£40,000 later, huh? Yeah, that's
complete.
Good. Yeah.
And what I'm saying is, in theory, yeah, maybe there is some idea you bring in negotiations. But as a matter of practice, what will it do? It will increase costs. It will lead to delay. And fundamentally, it is not what contract is about. If you look at the, I'm going to say the theory of what is contract, it's not, as Oliver Wendell Holmes said, the meeting of two different minds or anything. What it is the written form. And that's what it is. And anything else, generally, we'll come to factual matrix, but generally, is pernicious and undermines certainty. And that is why Singapore law approaches contract law in a much better way, I think, than modern English law. But other than that...
In what regard?
In regard to, for example, negotiations.
Narrower.
Much narrower in regard to implied term, in relation to factual matrix and implied terms are the two big ones.
We don't like listening to testimony about guys in bars in the world.
I'm focusing on Article 8.3.
Bernard, am I understanding you rightly that you now advocate that parties choose Singapore law,
not English law anymore? No, I advocate that that the English judges should reassert
themselves. Go back.
And not go back. I hate the word go back. Go forward. Always go forward. Never go back.
No.
I tell my children, never go back.
Implied terms anymore. No intermediate terms like Denning put it.
Again, English law is terribly simple. Yeah. You imply terms if it's necessary to make the contract work. You don't do it because it's reasonable or it's a good idea. And for about 3-4 years, English law went down the wrong route. Singapore law held in Singapore that the decision in the Privy Council called Belize was wrong. And the Court of Appeal and then the Supreme Court in Arnold and Britain agreed, in effect, with the Singapore Court. So for English law, for about 5 years, was on the wrong track. And then English law had to bring it back. Singapore law was far ahead of it. Singapore law. So I say to English law, I say to the English judges, they have to be more robust. They have to be more colonialist. They have to be more English. And the reason for that is not because of some great theoretical colonial idea, because that is what contracting parties want and need. And anything that dilutes that has to be looked at very, very carefully indeed. And my own view is that over the last 20 years, English law has gone down a slippery slope. And despite my attempts to keep it in the right place, I sometimes get overturned in the Court of Appeal, you see. So,
but it didn't bother him at all. A classicist? You're just a romantic, apparently, Ingeborg. What do you think? Is he right? English law has repaired itself after a brief lapse?
Well, I think I have to come back to what I said before. I think the time for legal colonialism has passed, indeed. And our task is not to say English law is better than anyone, but we have to deal with the issues. And actually, Bernard, I mean, civil law countries have had now more than 100 years of experience in interpreting interpretation provisions like the ones in the CISG, in the Swiss Civil Code. We have a very similar provision, and there are no delaying tactics, and it does not take days to interpret a contract because we have, on the face, we are paying tribute to the subjective intention, but that is not what we really do. And so why don't you rely on our experience, on the experience of all these lawyers interpreting the civil codes around the world, including the Brazilians? We have different notions of good faith sometimes, but I think let's sit down, let's discuss the problems, let's discuss the needs of contracting parties, and then we will find the appropriate solutions.
And it's also gooey, though, isn't it? Why don't we just look at the words they wrote down, you romantic? I want to leave some time for everybody to ask our combatants whatever questions or concerns have arisen. Here I am between a classicist and a romantic, though. I do want to leave you with one thought from maybe the most influential book written in the U.S. is by a Yale law professor named Grant Gilmore called The Death of Contract. And what he's writing about is the zoo of doctrines that came out in the common law because we were stuck and looking at words. Promissory estoppel, quasi-contract, implied in law contract, implied in fact contract, the things that the classicists just detest. And the way Gilmore concludes his thoughts is to say, quote, in literature and the arts, and perhaps in law, there are alternating rhythms of classicism and romanticism. During classical periods, which are typically of brief duration, everything is neat, tidy, and logical. Theorists and critics reign supreme. Formal rules of structure and composition are stated to general acclaim. During classical periods, which are, among other things, extremely dull, it seems that nothing interesting is ever going to happen again. But the classical aesthetic, once it has been formulated regularly, breaks down in a protracted romantic agony. The romantics burn the exquisitely stated rules of the preceding period. They experiment, they improvise, they deny the existence of any rules, they churn around in an ecstasy of self-expression, and at the height of the romantic period, everything is confused, sprawling, formless, and chaotic. As well as extremely interesting. So, thank you to Bernard and Ingeborg for their debate. Very much, thank you. There are, I believe, microphones that are available. If you have a question, a concern, a comment, anything short of physical violence, please summon a microphone-bearing person and we'll hear your question. Yes, sir.
Jim Daniels. Is it
on? Yes. It is.
Professor Schwenzer raised and told a very interesting anecdote about the German and the American contracting party, that had they used the contract, the international sale of goods, then one party would have won, and because it was Swiss law, the other party won. But this was an arbitration. An arbitration seeks equity within the law, not the law. What on earth is happening with arbitration if we are going to law, pure and simple?
Ingeborg, your anecdote, your first response. Yeah. I disagree with you, by the way. Arbitrations are based on law, but go ahead, Ingeborg.
Yes, so I would agree with you, Peter. And actually, arbitration and arbitrators are moving more and more away from equity and are basing their decisions on law and on legal considerations. And thus, it is important which law governs, which substantive law governs the contract of the parties. And in that case, it was a question of, for example, under the CISG, we have the common law concept of strict liability. Whereas under Swiss law, we still have a fault-based concept. So damages are due only if there's fault on the side of the contract breacher. So and that is a 19th century concept, actually. So many domestic legal systems are not fit to deal with nowadays problems. And if parties are choosing such a system, and not the CISG, then that really is fit for the problems of the 21st century. So they can be worse off.
Yeah. Well, I agree with Ingeborg almost entirely on that. And the premise is that arbitrators don't apply the law. I mean, the answer is they often don't apply the law. Well, then equity within the law, if equity is part of the law, then they are applying the law because equity is regarded as part of that law. No difficulty with regard to that at all. There is they often don't apply the law and then they get appealed perhaps or whatever. But there is an interesting point which is relevant to Article 8.3, and that is the question whether or not arbitrators are bound by the rules of evidence, and there is a view that arbitrators can decide independently of English law whether to allow certain evidence in or not. Now that is a very controversial issue, and I'm not going to even seek to say more than that, But generally speaking, arbitrators have to apply the law, and to the extent that equity forms part of that law, then that is what they do.
Right. Are there questions? In the middle there. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Christoph Miller from Switzerland. Thank you very much for your debate. I personally think that you are much closer than you pretend to be. Professor Schwenzer told us that the Swiss and the German and the CISG approach is much more objective than it looks like when you read Article 8. I think the English law with respect to the parallel evidence rule, we don't know whether it is dead already or not. With respect to the negotiation bar, it's sufficient to plead rectification, and then you have the all the negotiation within as well. But I have a question to Professor Ingeborg Schwenzer. Why do the civil law system still clinch to this romantic idea of subjective intent? And why do we still found it in Article 8, paragraph 1, if it never applies in practice? Because judges are simply not in a position to see in the parties' minds.
I think this is our 19th century heritage, actually. And it's still very strong, I mean, especially in Germanic legal systems, the influence of Savigny, to whom this is to be can be traced back, is still very strong. And that is a very bad influence, but reality is has gone another way. But we still keep this concept alive. And I mean, the CISG was drafted in the 1970s. Maybe if we were to draft it today, we were able, the civil law lawyers were able to go one step beyond that and really admit that we too part from an objective interpretation.
Other comments or questions for our combatants? Here down in the front. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Julie Forsyth. I'm a construction lawyer in London, and after it strikes me on the interpretation of contracts.
Can we turn her mic up?
Yep. Am I too close? Is that better?
Can you hear?
Is that better? That's better. Sorry.
No. Thank you.
Stop heckling. No, as after 30 years of drafting contracts under common law and then fighting for contracts at the other end in arbitration and in the TCC, it strikes me that if you are allowed to bring in this subjective side of it into the interpretation, the negotiations, that more personal side of it, that's going to have, I'd be interested to hear, but it would, I think, for a lot of people I know, have a major effect on the way that those contracts are negotiated, when people are aware, understand that someone's going to be digging down into that several years later when it reaches a court or an arbitration. Have you found...
How do you mean?
When you're negotiating a contract, when two commercial enterprises are negotiating, it's not always as clear-cut as just, well, we'd like this, well, we would like that, to reach the intent. There's a lot more strategy and tactical behavior in deciding how quickly it's going to be done, what the price is. And it's not always black and white. And some of that is not something that parties would always want to be brought to the attention of a court or a tribunal, I think. Not necessarily going to a fraudulent level, but just commercial negotiation.
Right.
And perhaps that would change the way that people, especially lawyers, I think, would approach negotiations. Maybe that's a good thing.
Well, and as our viz advocates will know, there's also an issue in the problem as to whether the negotiation has in fact failed. And when do people, how do you tell that people are done negotiating, and how do you tell that people really mean what they say during negotiations or are just threatening to reach an end? Bernard, what do you think about the change in practice if English law were to open up and allow evidence of negotiations, for example?
It's a nightmare scenario, that's my view. It's a complete nightmare from beginning to end. But it's even worse than it might otherwise be in listening to what you say, and is that a tactic might be developed
amongst negotiating lawyers to deliberately say something in the course of the negotiations, thinking that there is a possibility in 2 years' time that if a dispute arises, that they'll be able to rely on what they said in the negotiations to assist in the actual construction of the contract in a way which is, right. I mean, again, I think it is a night. I think it. There is much. I don't want to get. There is much in the CISG that I like, that I have no problem with, but this idea that subjective intent in Article 8.1. Well, it may say subjective intent, but as a matter of reality, it's never applied, so it doesn't really matter. To my mind, is heresy. I mean, I'm not prepared to sign up to a document on the basis that Ingeborg tells me that it doesn't often arise, or as a matter of reality, the judges will ignore it, or something of that kind. That's what it says. I will not sign up to a contract and not recommend any person to agree to a contract which depends in part and allows in one subjective intent and two negotiations. Full stop. And I think any regime that allows that, even on the basis that in reality it doesn't apply, so it doesn't matter, in my view, is pernicious and a nightmare scenario in any commercial transaction, period. It might be described as colonial, but that is my view.
Well, that's the fear. But you've lived with these cases where negotiations are admissible.
Yes.
And I kind of have sympathy for Berner's view, particularly in the American courts where we're trying these cases to juries. You know, in other words, we're trying to keep things as pure as possible.
Yeah, I mean, you have problems with
Isn't there
juries.
A risk of people manipulating, in other words, creating evidence during the course of negotiations, knowing that eventually it'll be admissible?
I think this is just a lack of experience with such provisions. And I mean,
that's what I'm wondering. You have experience.
Yeah, we have the experience in many civil law legal systems, and to my knowledge, it really does not happen. And I mean, you're mentioning another point which is peculiar to the United States, the jury system. I mean, England abolished the jury system in civil law cases, so you have special problems.
Well, that's true.
Unique to the United States that nowhere else in the world will never be found. That's why you go to arbitration. Yeah. So, and naturally, when we interpret a contract, we start from the wording of the contract. There are not many differences, actually.
Yeah. Well, the experience is that it doesn't happen, I guess, but we recognize the fear that you're expressing. Other fears, hopes, concerns, questions? Sir.
Hi, Frederico Singaraja, barrister at Hardwick. I've just come back from São Paulo, where I sat in the pre-moot there last weekend, in fact. And I sat and heard from a number of panels, three panels, and quite interestingly, there was Brazilian universities, a German university, and a Portuguese university, all civil law jurisdictions. So they focused quite a lot on 8.1 when they were presenting their arguments. And when I pushed them as to the meaning behind the other material, pre- and post-negotiations, we got into great discussions about the ambiguity of those documents. So, and being an English barrister, in fact, being before Sir Bernard in the past myself, I am very unaccustomed to having the opportunity to monologue when I'm presenting submissions. So when I pushed them, they became very, very uncomfortable. So my question is, are civil lawyers too soft?
Well, I mean, you had experience with students, and students, now I would have to talk about the education system. I know about the education system in quite a few civil law countries, and it's much too theoretical. And this notion of subjective intent, as I said, it's a 19th century notion that is very much upheld. And well, I always told my students, you know, Savigny was the worst thing that could happen to the Germanic legal systems, But I bet out of 100 law teachers teaching contract law, I'm the only one who says that. The rest, the 99 of my colleagues in civil law countries, they cherish Savigny as one of the greatest jurists of all time. So that is why if you talk to a student, for them, the subjective intent is so important. But that has to do, they don't have experience, yeah? They just reproduce what they have been told, primarily subjective intent. Only if we cannot find a subjective intent, then we go to objective criteria.
So yes is the answer, except Ingeborg. I don't recommend tangling with her. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Ray Warbicki, London. I see from the slide there that this is an arbitration debate. So just putting it in the arbitration context for a moment, I think what the gentleman over here said a few minutes ago, that the two of you are actually not so far apart, is particularly true in arbitration, because in arbitration, under almost any institutional rules or any set of rules, normally the arbitrators do not have to apply the strict rules of evidence. And in my experience, in most contract arbitrations, you have either an ambiguity or at least an awkwardness about provisions in the contract, and both parties will normally want to provide some evidence of what happened in negotiations. And with respect to Sir Bernard's comment, in my experience, that's not about discussions in bars. It's normally about documents that were exchanged in the course of negotiations or contract drafts that do provide some useful insights into what actually happened and what the meanings of these clauses are. The arbitrators are able to assess the probative value of that evidence and to take it into account in their decisions and their awards. So that on the ground, in my experience anyway, I don't think there is a great deal of difference whether you're operating under English law or the CISG or similar legal provisions that deal with this area.
Another common pattern, of course, is for both parties to say this contract is unambiguous, but their interpretations are contradictory. I'm sure you've seen that as well. Other questions or concerns or comments? Anybody?
Let me just say this. I agree with you in part, but there are two quite different things that we're talking about at the moment, and I do think they're very different. One is subjective intent, and one is negotiations. Certainly, so far as I am aware, I have never been involved in any arbitration, certainly governed by English law, where anyone has, they may have attempted, where the arbitrators have allowed in evidence subjective intent with regard to the meaning of a contract. And if they did do that, they shouldn't do that. And certainly none of the arbitration where I sit, I would allow that. Negotiations are different. And as a matter of English law, and in arbitration, as applied to arbitration, that the Lord Clerk in the Supreme Court has emphasized that there is a very fine line between negotiations on the one hand and what is called factual matrix on the other. And whereas I think negotiations are inadmissible and are inadmissible in arbitration and should be, I think factual matrix is different. And the English Commercial Court, if you don't know this, is really important, and I apply this in every arbitration I do. If any party is seeking to rely upon factual matrix, pre-contractual factual matrix, as an aid to construction, the English rules of court provide you have to set that out in a document, either in a pleading or in some separate document. And in every arbitration I do, if any party wants to adduce factual matrix, they have to put it into a document of some kind. And often, whenever that happens, the parties agree that that is factual matrix. And therefore, what I'm always concerned with is unnecessary delay and unnecessary cost. My focus is always on trying to help the parties arrive at a solution which is efficient for the conduct of the case. So I agree in part, but not in everything you say.
What do you say, sir? Do you disagree?
I'm speaking really in practical terms. I think it's more about ensure that the parties have a full, fair opportunity to present their case. And they don't want to be criticized for depriving the party of those rights, for example, by excluding some evidence that a party may want to call. So I think in practical terms, one does see and hear information that would fall within both categories, and decisions in arbitration tend to be made on the basis of information that could be introduced through either test, whether under the CISG or under English law. Perhaps Sir Bernard is quite different in his arbitrations and take a stricter view of the sort of information he allows the parties to present. But again, in my experience, that's more exceptional. In English arbitrations, as well as arbitrations under other jurisdictions.
Yeah, I agree with you that it is looser for the admissibility of evidence, but I wonder if that's an echo more of the New York Convention allowing grounds for non-enforcement being the refusal of the arbitral tribunal to hear material evidence, and the arbitrator is not willing to cut it too fine, rather than an echo of which legal regime you're under, like English law or CISG, I would say.
I entirely agree with that. I think the convention is important. The model law, which of course has very similar criteria, is important. The 1996 Act is drafted according to the same model, and institutional rules tend to follow those models, and if anything, give even broader scope to arbitrators to introduce and consider information, particularly when the parties themselves want to introduce it.
Thank you. One last comment, question, concern? Sir, you in the middle.
Yeah, thank you. Hello. Yes, so I had a question for Sir Bernard. So we've heard in recent times that arbitration has had a major impact on the development of the common law. Given how much you've spoken about in the context of the impact of principles and certainty and the importance of English law. We're grateful for your thoughts.
Okay, the question is arbitration not exactly contributing to the development of English law?
Well, this is the great debate that the Lord Chief Justice started, you will know, last March, and then I gave a speech a few weeks later disagreeing with him, in part. But I agree with him to this extent that the phenomenal growth of arbitration has tended over the years to obviously reduce the number of cases that would otherwise have gone to court. And to that extent, the development of the common law has been, I'm not sure, stifled, but certainly is less than might otherwise be the case. That is absolutely true. In a way, I wish it were otherwise, sir. I wish my children had stayed young. But sometimes it is, I'm not a magician. We live in the world that we live. And like Canute, you can't stop certain things. So yes, it has reduced that. But I disagree, so I agree with the Lord Chief Justice to that extent. But I disagree with the Lord Chief Justice in suggesting somehow that the English courts or the English law should be such to force people to take their disputes, instead of going to arbitration, to court, or widening the basis upon which you can appeal a case to the court. So the answer to your question is, I think it has, I'm not sure stifled, but hindered the development of common law. That's unfortunate, it is sad, but there we are.
To summarize then, London is so dominant, and English law is so preeminent that so many people are picking arbitration that the development of the English law itself is being hindered. Do you agree, Ingeborg? Anyway, we're done. Wine awaits you, I think, out at the top. Thank you to y'all.